So Professor Fernando Pedone is visiting us from the University of Svizzera Italiana, USI, in Switzerland. And he's full professor at that university since 2012. And he's been visiting us already 4 years with regular visits. And he's also has been visiting researcher at Cornell University and other universities, for instance. Authored more than 100 papers in important conferences in our area. This year, he's co-chair at PC co-chair at DSN, one of the most important conferences in our area. And so, Professor Pedone is with us for 2 weeks now, and this is a short stay. And today, he's going to talk about his work and some of aspects we have been doing together too, included in that area. So it's a pleasure to have you here, Professor Pedone. We are most delighted with your visit, and I hope the audience can enjoy your talk.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And it's I have to say it's been a pleasure to collaborate with Dutch and a few other people in Brazil and in the south of Brazil. So this talk is about scalable dependability. It's related to some of my research activities and also to the collaboration we have been going on for some time. And I must acknowledge that the title is a little bit cryptic. So let me try to start by explaining what the scalable dependability means. So dependability is a broad term. It's used to characterize systems that are reliable, they can tolerate failures, and also are secure. So for the purpose of this work, dependability here means highly available, and I will detail what this means in a moment. So the motivation for this work is based on the observation that modern online services, and this is pretty much any service that is available on the internet, right, they have two requirements. The first one is they must be highly available. Essentially, they must be always operational, no matter what happens to the components, like server crashes or communication leak problems. They should always be available. That's the expectation of the clients, right? And the second requirement is that they must be scalable. So high availability is something that has existed for quite some time now, several decades, actually. Scalability is a more recent request. Essentially, because some of these systems, they can become super successful and attract a very large user base. So the idea of a scalable service is that it can accommodate ever-growing number of requests. So your system becomes more popular, like think of a social network, for example. If it attracts many users, right, these users are going to create more and more load, so your system has to be able to accommodate this additional load, even if by allocating more physical resources. But the key point is that the software that powers these services, they must be able to make use of these resources. So scalable dependability is essentially is a class of systems that can tolerate failures, or sorts of failures. It can also grow to accommodate a growing need. Right? So as I said, high availability has existed for quite some time. So there are many different mechanisms to provide high availability. But the main, actually, mechanism that exists to make systems fault-tolerant or highly available is replication. So essentially, we replicate the components or replicate the data, right, according to different techniques. It also, replication can provide some scalability to a lesser degree. For scalability, the main technique, the main idea that many systems exploit is state partitioning. So you take the state of your system composed of, so it's very much application specific. If it's a file system, you can take different files or different parts of a file, and you can partition this. Essentially means you can store the various parts in different servers. And the idea behind this is that you have multiple servers to serve requests, not a single machine. So state partition is also sometimes called sharding. I'm going to use the two terms in this talk. So the starting point of this work, right, this research effort is techniques that were designed for high availability. And one technique in particular, which is called state machine replication. So this technique was proposed many, many years ago, right, by someone called Leslie Lamport, who is a Turing Award. And he had mostly theoretical interest for quite some time until there was a real need for such kind of systems. And since then, state machine application has been included in many quite important systems. Some of them are listed here. So Google Spanner, it's a storage system. It implements state machine replication. Apache Zookeeper, Windows Azure Storage has also some parts that are based on state machine replication. So the next two, MySQL Group Replication and Galera Cluster, these are databases, distributed databases, highly available. They are highly available. They are not entirely relying on state machine replication, but some crucial parts of the system, they depend on SMR, right, state machine replication. And more recently, perhaps that's the one that I suppose everybody has heard of, is blockchain, right? At the very core of the main blockchain systems, what there is state machine replication, right? And as we'll see, the technique is quite effective for high availability. Unfortunately, it doesn't work so well for scalability. So let me tell you in a few words what state machine replication is, right, and why it's very popular. So the technique is quite simple and intuitive, and it's simple for the clients that use the system, right, and it's also it's simple for the application developers. These are the people who are building services using this technique. And more technically, the reason why it is intuitive is because it provides what you call replication transparency. So replication transparency is the following. If you look at this picture here, we can see that these boxes, they represent servers, right? And because I have three of them, I have the servers replicated. So there's three replicas of the server. Having three replicas of the server, I can tolerate the crash of some of them, right? And the service is still running. Now, from the perspective of the users, they want the high availability feature of this service, but they don't want to program systems that are replicated, because writing a program for many servers is much more complicated than writing a program for a single server. So the challenge here is that you want to provide high availability by means of replication, but you don't want to make the task of the application designers more complicated. So the users and the application developers, they should think of the system as if it was a single server. It behaves as a single server, right? But in reality, it's replicated and it can tolerate failures. So that's the whole idea of replication transparency, something that is provided by state machine replication, right? And the model, besides being intuitive, it's also quite simple. So all it takes is two steps. The replicas, they must receive all the commands. So the commands is the requests coming from the clients. All the replicas, they should receive all the commands in total order, in the same total order. So if commands C1 and C2 are submitted to the servers, every replica should receive first C1 and C2, or the order is wrong. So it must be totally ordered. And the second requirement is that every replica has to execute every command in the same order and deterministically. This means that starting from the same state and processing the same command, the replica should produce the same results and the same final state. Right? If they do that, essentially what happens is that every replica is going to transition through the same sequence of states, right? So they produce the same results. It doesn't matter which result the clients receive, as long as they receive some of these results. So that's the idea. So as I said, It's conceptually simple. Now, implementing this in a distributed setting subject to failures is much more complicated. And actually, implementing this ordering in execution is a bit harder than it sounds. But conceptually, the idea is quite simple, right? So one aspect of state machine replication is that while it provides configurable fault tolerance, I can deploy as many replicas as I want, right? It depends on how many failures I want to tolerate. Typically, systems deploy three replicas. Some systems deploy more. Blockchain systems, they target hundreds of replicas. Doesn't mean that they scale to so many replicas, but that's the goal, right? I can actually configure how much fault tolerance I have by deploying more or fewer replicas. However, from the point of view of performance, it doesn't matter how many replicas I have, right, or how many servers I have, the performance of my system is constant. So this little graph here, it shows throughput is number of commands that can be executed by a time unit, by per second, for example. And here's the number of servers I have. So this picture here, it's even a little bit optimistic. If I increase the number of replicas I have in my system, the performance decreases, right? And the reason why it decreases is because to ensure this same order, it requires my servers to communicate. And the more servers I have, the more communication there is. So typically, the performance decreases with the number of replicas. So it doesn't provide scalable performance. Yeah. So this is what I'd like to have. I'd like to have a replicated system that, by increasing the number of servers, I can also get better throughput. And that's essentially, at a very high level, this is the goal of this project, right? Is how to make state machine replication, a well-known technique that's deployed everywhere, scalable, without sacrificing any of the nice features of state machine replication. Okay, so this is an outline of the rest of this talk. I'm going to detail a little bit more. We're going to delve into each one of these aspects, right, and present to you some of the ideas we have to actually make this happen, a prototype, where we are, some data from performance evaluations, and then what you plan for the future. Okay, so the system model is essentially just a more of a disclaimer than anything else. This talk is not so technical, right? But I have to tell you what I'm expecting from the environment. I'm assuming a distributed system. I have the system is asynchronous. It means essentially that I don't have any strict assumptions about the time it takes for methods to be exchanged in the system, or even for the computers to execute their code. So I assume that it can take an arbitrary amount of time for a message to be submitted and for some computation to be done. Right? The servers, they all communicate by message passing as opposed to shared memory. Some systems, they can communicate by sharing the same memory. That's not the case. I'm only tolerating crash failures. Essentially, this means that if a failure happens, is some component stops executing. I'm not assuming arbitrary behavior from the replicas, at least not in this talk. This is Byzantine behavior is typically what blockchain systems they tolerate, right? It's any arbitrary behavior from the servers. And I'm dividing my system into partitions, so I'm actually using state partitioning, and I'll tell you how I do that. And then we rely on PUCRS. I will say a little bit more about that later in this talk. Okay, so how can I scale a system using state partitioning? This slide here, it shows a very simple way to do it, right? So we have our users and the regional services state here on the left, these two small boxes are supposed to mean the state of my application. So what state partition allows us to do is to take part of this service state and store it in one set of replicas, and another part of my state and store this another set of replicas. Right. So these are the two partitions. And by doing this, what I expect to have is something that resembles this graph here. As I increase the number of servers, in reality, as I increase the number of partitions, right, I can get throughput that grows proportionally. That's the goal. Now, at the same time, I can increase the number of, if I want to, I can replicate each partition, right? So I get fault tolerance by replicating servers within a partition, and I get scalability by increasing the number of partitions. Now, the fine print is that I'm going to get increasing throughput, scalable performance for single partition commands, right? So when I partition the state of my system, it means that some commands are going to be executed in partition PX, some commands are going to be executed in partition PY, right? As long as I have only single partition commands that can be entirely executed within a partition, as I increase the number of servers, I can hope to have this behavior. Now, you might be wondering, well, this looks too easy, you know? How can you just get scalability by partitioning this stuff? Now, the hard part is, what about those commands that access X and Y? So what do I do with them, right? And that's essentially where the challenge lies. So back to state machine replication, right? There are in a system that looks like this, I have to tell you how to order commands and how to execute commands. Because if you remember, state machine replication requires all servers to execute commands in the same order and execute commands deterministically, right? So there's the ordering part and there's the execution part. So the question here is, how can I order commands in an environment like this? And then the second question is, how can I execute commands in a partitioned system? Is the problem you just mentioned? What if some command accesses data in multiple partitions? So today, I will not tell you how to order commands, right? I will focus the discussion mostly on the second part. It's not because the first part is not interesting, it's very interesting as well. We have spent quite some time working on ordering commands in distributed partition environments. But that would be a talk in itself. There's a lot of stuff to be said about ordering commands. I'm just going to, I just have one slide on the ordering of commands so that you understand more or less how things work, right? So essentially, what you want to achieve is some of these commands, depending on what the command accesses, right, they must be ordered within a single partition, right? And here I can use standard mechanisms. So one of them is called multiplexes. It's an algorithm to order things within a partition. But now I have to care about commands that go to multiple partitions, so C, X, Y. And for those commands, I have to make sure that these partitions, they order them consistently, right? If two commands go to X and Y, they should be ordered consistently. Every partition should see the commands in the same way, right? I'm oversimplifying here. Even defining the properties of these communication primitives is kind of tricky. But I just want to give you a general idea about how this part works, right? I have something. I have a protocol that ensures a consistent order of commands to other partitions. Okay, so let's go back to the main part of the focus of the talk. How can I execute multi-partition commands, right? And so for single partition commands, there's nothing new. It's just vanilla state machine replication, right? It's a deterministic execution, one after the other. Now, here, things are more complicated. If I have, let's take perhaps the simplest command I can think of. I'm assigning the value of y to variable x, right? And x and y, they are in different partitions. So what happens here is that the partition on the top, it cannot execute this assignment because it doesn't know the value of y. And the partition at the bottom, it cannot execute the assignment either because it doesn't know what to do with x. It doesn't store x. So that's essentially the problem I have to solve, right? Well, it turns out that there are different ways to solve this problem. I'm going to talk about two of them. One is based on static partitioning. Static partitioning means I partition my state and then I start the system. And once I start, I don't change the location of the data. The data stays where it was in the beginning of the execution. And then I have a different solution, which is dynamic partitioning. I can actually change my data items, can change locations, right? So these two strategies here, they allow, they provide different execution models for these multi-partition commands. Okay, so solution number one, step scheme. Oh, by the way, if you guys have any questions, don't be shy. Just raise your hand and it's more interesting the discussion. Okay, the first one is the static scheme. Again, I assign my data items to the various partitions and they don't change partition during the execution. So the clients, they have access to an oracle that tells the location of each object, right? This oracle can be quite simple because the partition is static. I can say, for example, as it's typically done, I hash the ID of my data item and the result of this hash tells the partition where the data item is. So the clients, they have to query the location oracle to know which partitions are involved in the command, right? And then they multicast the command to all involved partitions using this primitive that I just mentioned. I didn't explain to you how it's actually implemented, right? There is a way to actually to forward the commands to the various partitions consistently. And then the partitions, they exchange, right, the objects needed for the execution of this command. So the commands are executed by all the involved partitions, and then they all respond to the client, and then the execution goes on. Right. So as I said, the location oracle can be quite simple, essentially because data items, they don't change location. Right? So it can be even hard-coded in the clients. So take an object ID, and then hash it, and then you get the partition, essentially. So this is a picture that illustrates, back to the multi-partition command. I'm assuming that this command is a multicast to the partitions involved, in this case partition X and partition Y. So what these partitions have to do is, essentially, partition Y has to forward the value of Y to partition X, to the servers in partition X, Servers and partition Y, they don't have to receive anything from partition X, they just create a cached value of X. But now that they do this, they can both execute the assignment, right?
They can, now they know how to execute this X receives Y. And they do it, they respond to the client, and then for the client, it's as if the command was executed by a single partition. So that's a bit of the idea. So let me go through this once again to make sure that we all understand it. It's important to then compare to the alternative approach, right? So here, the execution starts on the client side. The client queries the Oracle. Essentially, it determines the partitions involved in the command. Oh, by the way, there's an important caveat here, which is the clients, by looking at the command, you must be able to tell what are the objects that the command needs. There is a lot to be said about that too. I'm going to get back to this at the end of this talk, right? But I'm assuming that the clients, they know. So in the case of that simple command I showed before, X receives Y, the clients can inspect the code and oh, I need X and Y before the command is multicast, right? Because the client needs to know the object so that it can query its Oracle and know the partitions that are involved in the execution of this command. So it multicast the command to all the involved partitions, and now the execution flows to the server side. The servers, all the servers involved in this command, they deliver the command, right? And then they check, are all the objects local? If they're all local, essentially this is a single partition command, and then they execute the command and they send the result back to the client. If not, then the servers in the various partitions involved, they should exchange these objects. They have to wait until they receive the object they need so that they can execute it. Is that clear? Okay. Now, let's move to the alternative approach, which is dynamic scheme, right? The key idea here, I'm not going to give you too much details because this is a lot more complicated than the other one, but the key idea here is, well, let's try to turn every command into a single partition one. Well, that sounds kind of, well, how can you do that? Well, the idea is, if a command involves multiple partitions, so we move the objects to a single partition so that they are all relocated for the execution of this command. So instead of having the various partitions exchange all the data that they need, they move all the objects to a single partition. Now, okay, there are different ways to choose which partition this should be. You know, we want to minimize communication across servers. But you move them all to the same partition, so now they all reside in one place. Then the servers, they can execute this command. Things get more complicated here because now the Oracle, it must be involved in this relocation of objects, right? Initially, in the previous scheme, you define, before the execution starts, X resides in partition PX and Y resides in partition PY. Now, the location of X and Y, it changes throughout the execution. So how do I know what's the partition that currently stores the value of X and Y? So that's what the Oracle does. The Oracle keeps track of the current location of every object. Right? So the queries, the client, they actually have to query the Oracle. The Oracle is a real entity, it's not embedded in the code of the client. One way to do this is to implement the Oracle as a special partition. So there's one partition that keeps track of the mapping of variables or object IDs into partitions. Right? And so every move operation, every time I have to relocate some object, I have to involve the Oracle, and of course the source and the destination partitions. Right. So this is a flowchart for this scheme. So the execution starts at the client queries its Oracle. Is it a single partition command? If it is, then you simply multicast the command to the partition, and then it's going to be executed and you get the result. Right. Now, if it's not, if it's a multi-partition command, or in better terms, if this execution of this command requires data from multiple partitions, right, then we have to move the objects to a single partition. And once this is done, right, then the client can multicast the command to the one partition that contains the data. Now, things are a little bit more complicated. And that's why I have this loop going back to all the beginning of the execution, because the following can happen, you know. Some client comes and aggregates all the data that he needs for single partition. And before he has a chance to multicast the command to the single partition, some other client comes and moves the data to some other partition because it wants to execute its own commands, right? And then what happens is, after the first client moved all the objects to one partition, and until the command is multicast, the objects are not there anymore. So that's why, on the servers that deliver the command, they have to check again, are all the objects local? So do I have all the objects for this command? Or do I have any of the objects for this command? If the answer is yes, then the server executes the command, and then just goes back to the client, and you are done. But it may happen that this unfortunate case where some other client aggregate the data in some other partition, right? And the partition that delivered the command, it doesn't have the objects anymore. In this case, the result back to the client is, well, you have to retry. And then we go through the same. Or maybe saying, well, isn't there a danger here that this thing never ends?
Yes, there is a liveness problem. And I will tell you how we cope with this. But there is a potential that commands are just retried over and over again.
Let me illustrate one important consequence of the moves, right? So the move that may lead to retries for the reason I just said. Here we have a very simple execution. I'm depicting the partitions as a single server, so it's a single line, because there's a lot of stuff going on in this picture here already, so I'm not gonna, but in reality, I have these partitions here, replicated, right? There's a number of servers here. I'm depicting a single one. And I also, I'm showing the current location of object X. So let's assume that, so here we have time on the X-axis, and so up to this moment here, object X was stored at partition P1. And the command is, this client 1 wants to read the value of X. So it queries the Oracle. The Oracle contains the location, it returns the location of object X, which happens to be P1, right? That's correct information. The client receives this information, and then it can, and then it's going to multicast the command. But before it does that, client 2 decides that object X must move to partition P2. For example, because client B is accessing other data items that are at partition P2. So it moves object X to partition P2, and by the time the client submits its command, it's no longer at partition P1, so it receives a retry, right? It's going to query the Oracle once again. And now this time, the Oracle is going to say, well, we should try P2. And in this execution here, the second time is more lucky. And the partition P2 actually contains the object. It executes and returns the result. Right? So that's essentially just a different way to show what I said before. Now, there are two aspects here that we should care about. The first one is this liveness problem, right? I want my commands to eventually terminate. The second problem is the Oracle is involved in the execution of every command. Then you may think, oh, hold on. You are partitioning the system to get better performance, right? But you rely on a single partition to execute every command. Isn't that a bit contradictory? So it's possible to believe that the Oracle is going to become a performance bottleneck, because it has to be involved in every command. So that's not good. So I have to do something about that. So, so these are the two aspects. So we have to ensure termination of all commands. So how we do it? After retrying a certain number of times, right? And if it's always, the response is always a retry, what the clients do is they switch back to a more restrictive way to do it. We multicast the command to all the partitions, right? And they tell the partition they exchange the data, just like we have in the static approach. So this is much more expensive. We have to multicast it to all partitions, and they have to all exchange data. So most of the time, almost always, we get the commands executed before you get this step, right? So this is a measure to ensure that if I'm really in trouble retrying these commands, eventually it's going to finish. So I can prove that my system is live. It ensures termination using a heavyweight mechanism. But there is a mechanism to ensure that. Now, for load balancing, for reducing the load on the partitions, I can also I have to choose where to place my objects. Right. So the client chooses, and here you can, I guess the simplest way is you just choose some random. So the aggregates all the objects in one of the partitions that is involved in the command. I'm going to talk about some more sophisticated ways to do it, but in principle the client can choose, just aggregate them all in some partition, and then execute the command. Now, with respect to the Oracle,
so the Oracle has to tolerate failures, right? Because after all, it's involved in the execution of the command. The way to do it is we can implement the Oracle as a partition. Every partition is replicated, right? And for the performance problem, instead of relying on the Oracle for every single command, clients, they can cache some of the entries. Now, if the client caches the entries and the entries are up to date, so the execution of the command does not involve the Oracle at all, right? It's completely local to the clients.
Now, of course, this is a cached entry, so it may happen that the data that the client has is outdated, and as a consequence, it's going to lead to retries. Right? For example, as I have here, right? I have a client now. I added to this picture the cache at the client. But in this case, the cache is saying that X is a partition P1, which in reality it's not, right? It's in the partition P2, but the client doesn't know it yet. Last time the client checked, X was in partition P1, so that's why it's cache says. Then somebody else changed it, and the client wasn't adverted. Now, the client's gonna query its local Oracle, so it's a local operation, very efficient. And then it multicast the command to partition P1. Well, what it gets as a response is we have to retry it because I don't have object X. Now, when the client retries, then it has to involve the Oracle, right? And then the Oracle is going to say, oh, it's good too. And then it can execute the command successfully. Now, luckily for us, even before the caches were introduced, the clients, they must be capable of retrying commands, right? Because things can move, as I showed before. So adding a cache to the client didn't introduce any major complications in the execution of commands. The possibility of retrying commands was there already before, right? Okay, so let me recap where you are right now. We have two different mechanisms to execute commands in a partition state machine replication environment. This first one relies on static partitioning, right? We have single partition and multi-partition commands. Every command is multicasted to all the involved partitions. The servers in the various partitions, they exchange some data so that they can execute the commands. The partitioning is static. If I want to relocate my objects, I have to shut down my system, move the location of these objects, and start again. On the plus side, I have a simple Oracle. Now, the dynamic scheme, the idea is that every command becomes single partition, because I'm moving the data to a single partition before I execute the command. I have my dynamic partition of objects, so you know, I have to keep track of that. And the Oracle is the entity that it stores the mapping, so it has to be involved whenever data is relocated. Right.
Now the question is, okay, so if I focus on the dynamic scheme, right, how can I actually, how can I choose the location of my objects? There are at least two techniques to do it. The first one is completely decentralized, and essentially the client chooses. So the client identifies all the partitions involved, and based on the partitions involved, it chooses one partition to host all the objects. For example, it chooses the partition that has most of the objects, or chooses the partition that has the largest objects to reduce overhead. And so the advantage of this is that there is no single entity that's making these decisions, that's making the decision of how to partition. Every client does it. It has good performance in under certain conditions, which I'm calling here strong locality. And I'll tell you in a minute what strong locality means. So it's simpler conceptually. It provides good performance in some cases. Now, it has slow convergence. What I mean by that is it may take some time until I find the distribution of objects in my system, partitioning of objects that leads to this good performance. But if I don't have this strong locality, then the performance is quite poor. Now let me tell you what this thing is. Here we have a small system, two partitions only, and every vertex here is an object, right? And the edges in this graph, essentially, they represent the command, how commands access the objects. In this case here, this edge means that there is a command that accessed these two objects. Now, this edge here means there's another command that accessed these two objects, right? So in this partitioning here of my system, I have one, two, three commands that are going to involve data repartitioning, right? And the others, this, this, and this, and this, they are single partition. Now, if you look at this graph, there is a better way to partition my system so that I avoid data movement, right? So if I repartition my system this way, every command becomes now single partition. So even if I start from that, if I start from some random distribution of data, right? If my workload it presents a strong locality, and that's essentially what I mean by strong locality. You can completely partition my graph without crossing any edges. Right? If the workload allows it, then eventually I'm going to reach this state here, and then once I reach this state here, I have zero data movement. So every command becomes essentially single partition. But the workload, it has to admit this kind of partition. So if it does, eventually I'm going to reach the system, this state. Perhaps I have slow convergence. It's going to take a lot of commands to actually reshuffle this stuff and tune it if they are in the right places. And if I don't have this, then performance is poor. I know it's poor, and I will show it experimentally later, but as a fact, it doesn't perform so well. So how can you do better than that? Well, we can rely on a centralized strategy. So the centralized strategy, it involves the Oracle, which is already keeps track of the data location, right? So the Oracle, it builds a graph of objects and their relations, a graph that resembles the one I just showed in the previous slide, right? And from time to time, if this is configurable, can be, more or less the same intervals of time, or it can be based on how busy the system is. From time to time, the Oracle looks at this graph and partitions it. For example, using, standard graph partitioning, like the one we use Metis. Essentially what this tool does, it takes as the input a graph, right, and a number of partitions, and then it tries to find the best way to partition this. Not the best, but it tries to find a good way to partition the graph so that we get a balance across the various partitions, right, and we minimize the number of edge cuts. So there are two metrics to be optimized, right? Because one way to essentially avoid edge cuts, move everything to the same partition, but then can defeat the purpose of the system. So you want to both find some balancing across partitions and minimize the number of edge cuts. That's essentially what metrics does. Now, a technique like this, it has good performance with strong and weak locality, right? Of course, there are limits on what this can achieve. I'll show experimentally later. So it has fast convergence because once I partition my graph, I know exactly where I have to move my object so that it minimizes the number of good partition commands. Now, on the downside, the Oracle knows the location and the relation of the object, so it increases the state of the Oracle. And besides, well, we know that partitioning a graph is not really a simple problem. Metis does a good job, so depending on the size of the graph, it can take some time. And essentially, it's not optimal, so it doesn't produce the... But it produces a reasonable partition, as I have seen experimentally. Okay, so that's essentially, in summary, what the strategies are. We want to see how to behave in a real system, right? Well, as close to a real system as you can get. So all this stuff has been implemented. We have a library for scalable state machine replication that integrates all the approaches that I mentioned before. And then there's a question of what application should we choose. We wrote our social network, something that resembles Twitter in some ways, right? And but very simplified. We have two commands. We have a get timeline where you get users can post messages in the network, and all the friends receive the message. It's like normal social network, and then you can get all the messages that have been posted by all your friends. Right? So, given this social network service, we built this particular instance of it, which I call the sports social network. I don't know if this exists, but the idea is the following. So users, they like to play some sport, and then they declare what they like in this case here, people like to play tennis and volleyball. And then they create connections based on what they like, and most likely they're going to be related to other people who play the same sports, right? So if I have a system like this,
I have to, so I can either store it all entirely inside a single partition, it's going to be fault tolerant, but it's not going to scale as the number of users grows, right? As my social network becomes more popular, it's going to integrate more users, and then this single set of servers may be overwhelmed, and they can't actually execute the other requests. So I want to partition my system. This is one possible partition. So it has a balanced load, more or less the same number of users in each partition, and it has few cross-partition interactions. Actually, there's only two.
Right.
Now, I also want to integrate to accommodate chains. For example, people decide that they want to play tennis as well, so that creates other connections. And all of a sudden, the partitioning that I had here, the original one, is not so good. Right. And this is a problem that the static partitioning would suffer. So as the behavior of the system changes, I'm stuck to the very first partitioning that I had, and which is not so good. So for the dynamic scheme, I can actually change my partitioning, and I can choose one that's actually best for the last relation that I added. Now I have, I'm reducing the number of crossing edges by moving a user that was on partition on the right to the partition on the left, given by the dashed red line. Okay, so how can I implement my get timeline in my post commands? It's important that you understand that, because I'm going to show some results, and the performance of these results, they depend a lot on the way these operations are implemented. So for the get timeline, every command is single object. So the reason why a get timeline is single partition is because the posts, right? When a user posts something in the system, we create a copy of the post and store at each client. Each client that's related to this user. So essentially, the posts are more expensive, right? To make the get timelines cheaper. So they are all single partition by construction, right? Now the post commands, they may be single partition or multi partition. It depends where the friends of a particular user are located. If all the friends of a user are located in the same partition, the post is going to be a single operation. If the friends are spread in different partitions, then the post is going to be a multi-partition operation. Now, I'm going to show it. So I'm going to evaluate the performance of these two commands under two different kinds of workloads. The first one is strong locality. Again, I can partition my social graph so that there is zero cross partition commands. And then I'm going to consider also weaker forms of locality, where in the best case, there is 1% of crossing edges and 5% of crossing edges in my network. Essentially, I'm using different networks, right? Just change the friendship relation, and then I can get in one of these configurations. OK, so first, good news. For get timelines, right, as I said, by design, they are all single partition operations. So in this graph here, I'm evaluating the throughput of get timelines, and I'm varying the number of partitions in my system from 1 up to 8. Every partition contains 3 replicas. And here on the y-axis, I have the throughput in kilo commands per second. So essentially, this means that for a single partition, right, this is standard state machine replication, I can get a little bit more than 20,000 commands per second. But as I increase the number of partitions, I'm increasing the throughput proportionally. Well, that's not a big surprise, right? Because the get timelines, they are entirely local operations. So I can keep increasing the performance of my system by adding more partitions. Now, as you see, the cost of adding more partitions, it shows in the performance of the post. So the other interesting thing in this graph is that all the techniques, they perform the same. There's no difference. Well, state machine replication, classic state machine replication, it only assumes a single partition, right? So that's what you have. Now, all the other ones, all the other techniques, they deliver the same performance. Essentially, the way they execute commands is pretty much the same, because it's just multiple instances of state machine replication. But it's an interesting result. I mean, it shows that for get timelines, which is by far the most popular operations, I get pretty decent performance. Now let's look at the more difficult case, which is the posts, right? So here I'm getting what I was hoping for in the beginning of this talk, linear improvements in performance. Okay, so the easiest case for posts, which is zero edge cuts. So here I have to explain one of the bars in this graph. So we have classic state machine replication, single partition. I'm not even showing the others because they are all the same, same performance. Now, I have this static technique. Remember it, it's either commands going to be local or going to be global. I have some distribution of my objects. And then I have the two flavors of the dynamic technique, the decentralized and the centralized. Decentralized, the clients choose based on some local criteria. Decentralized, the Oracle builds this graph and then applies some graph partitioning algorithm. And then I have here a baseline, which I call my optimal static. What is this? So the static, I assume that my original partitioning, which is done in the beginning of execution, it knows what the social network will be. So it's a baseline, because in reality, I don't have this information in practice. I don't know what relationships my users are going to develop. I actually know it because I'm creating the social network. So I know in advance what kind of links I'm going to introduce to the social graph. So I know this. So I can build my partitioning by taking this into account. Now, it's only for comparison purposes because it's impossible to implement it. But it gives us a baseline. This is a pretty good mechanism. If I knew the future, then I could do this using the static approach. So for 0% of edge cuts, I mean, for a strong locality, there is a way. It doesn't mean that I know what the way is, but there is a way to partition this graph. So that the static approach, which starts with a random distribution of objects, it performs pretty poorly because many commands are going to be cross-partitioned. Right? So it doesn't deliver a good performance for the posts. Now, the other techniques, the dynamic, the centralized, and the optimal, they all deliver pretty decent performance. So the reason here is the dynamic techniques, they eventually reach this partitioning that's very favorable. The decentralized keeps trying for some time, perhaps making wrong placements of data. But I keep running this long enough, eventually all the objects, they end up in the place where it's going to be perfectly partitioned. Decentralized is even better because I'm actually observing what's going on and I try to find a partition that's favorable. And finally, the optimal, it also does it because I start from the beginning with the partitioning that is the best. So I know what the workload is, I partition and then I distribute the data. So that's why we get this. So it doesn't, for this kind of workloads, it doesn't matter actually what I use. Now let's make this a little harder and introduce some additional edge cuts. So look at a weaker notion of locality. Oh, sorry, before I get there, so this picture here, it shows the difference between the centralized and the decentralized, right? And the graph on the top, it shows time versus the number of moves per second. So what you can see is that there's quite some operation in the beginning of the execution, until there's a point after which all the objects they find their ideal partition, and then there is pretty much zero moves. And as a consequence, the graph at the bottom, it shows throughput versus time. Now, in the beginning, throughput is kind of low because there's a lot of data moving back and forth. But once the data actually finds its best destination, then the performance kind of remains more or less constant. You can also see that the centralized technique, it reads this better performance earlier, essentially because the Oracle is looking at the execution and finding a good partition, as opposed to the decentralized approach where the various clients are just choosing partitions randomly and hoping that they're going to end up in the best place. Okay, so in other words, decentralized converts faster to the peak performance than the decentralized technique. Now, make it a bit harder, right? 1% of edge cuts. What happens here is the decentralized technique, which essentially, again, chooses partitions randomly, it doesn't perform so well because it's impossible to partition this. There's no easy way to partition this. Right? The workload is not so favorable. Clients keep just trying, and then it's unlikely that they're going to, this thing is going to converge to some good partitioning. Just because clients keep changing data. Now, if you are smarter about that and you actually look at what's going on and you try to explicitly find a better partitioning, then you can still deliver decent performance, which is comparable to our measure of our baseline, the optimal static.
Now, from here, if I keep adding more edge cuts, what happens essentially is the following. Intuitively, the more edge cuts I have, the less locality I have in my workload, the weaker the locality is, right? The worse the performance is going to be. I mean, these two bars here, they remain similar, right? After all, the optimal is static. I know what's the best way to do it, or one of the very optimized way to do it, and I start from that configuration. For the other ones, I keep redoing it as I go, right? But what happens as I introduce more edge cuts is that the problem is going to lower. Now, this graph here, it shows, again, it explains why, go back to the previous slide, why the centralized dynamic is better than the decentralized, right? It's essentially because the decentralized, by simply choosing randomly some target partition, you never guess to actually a good way to distribute the data. And as a consequence, you always have a very large number of moves, which translates into low performance, right? And if I have a smarter way to do it with the Oracle, I can reduce the number of moves. I can go directly to the best location. And as a consequence, I can get better throughput. So we also have experiments with 5% of edge cuts. And in this case here, essentially, the performance of most of the systems, it just decreases with respect to the previous one, and this line keeps decreasing. Another interesting fact about this picture here is that it takes 4 partitions to get the performance of a single instance of state machine replication. Essentially, the reason why this happens is multi-partition domains, they have a large cost, right? And eventually, and it doesn't really take too long, I'm going to need lots of partitions to get the performance of even a single state machine replication, right? Which is so the limits I can get from out of state partition.
Okay, so essentially that's, I guess, this is my last slide. So we're scaling state machine replication. I guess there's no question it's possible, right? But locality is fundamental if I want to get good performance.
And you may say, well, this is not so surprising. Actually, it happens in other areas of computer science. So the reason why you get operating systems that perform so well and databases that are so efficient is because they rely heavily on locality, right? Operating systems, the notion of a cache, it works because there's a lot of locality.
So this notion is all over the place in many different areas of computer science. So perhaps it comes as not so surprising that it's also fundamental in distributed highly available systems. So why else are you doing this in this direction? As I said, this is work that has been going on for some time. What I talked about here is work of 3 PhD students, perhaps even a few more. Some of these people are still working on this. Ideally, what you'd like to do is to come up with some decentralized scheme, right, that would behave like the centralized one. It's kind of it sounds a bit far-fetched, but that would be we don't need the Oracle to actually reach its best state. Right? It would be in other words, it would be a decentralized mechanism to partition a graph, if you will. It's an area of research in itself. Another aspect in this we've been looking into is how to expand this to more complex applications. So you may remember, when I said in the beginning, that the clients, to multicast the commands, they have to know all the objects that a command needs. Right. In some cases, this is not so complicated. But if the application you are implementing on top of the system is a data structure, like a linked list or a B-tree. When the client submits some command for this data structure, like a search, for example, it doesn't know which objects are going to be involved because it doesn't have the data structure. So how can clients estimate the partitions involved? Right? There has to be some mechanism to actually overcome this limitation. It turns out that there are ways in which you can do it. You can move more knowledge to the client side so they can actually guess at least what the location is. But it requires more sophisticated mechanisms to actually generalize this execution model
to more complex data structures. Like they said, essentially any data structure with pointers, for example, has this problem, right? How can you know before you execute the command what are the objects needed? You only know the objects needed after you execute the command. But in this execution model here, that's too late, right? You have to multicast to the concerned partitions. So that creates a kind of cyclic dependency. So this is something that we've been doing. In addition to that, the notion of scalability in the context of state-machine replication, it doesn't necessarily imply having more servers, more partitions. I can also make better use of a single set of servers. One of the requirements of state-machine replication is that the execution must be deterministic. So essentially, deterministic execution, it means sequential code, right? You have a single thread executing all the code of an application. For we all know that pretty much any computer these days, like mine here, it has a few cores, right? So if you are running state-machine replication in my laptop, it's going to be subutilized because most of the cores are going to be doing nothing. There's just a single core executing so that the execution is deterministic. So another side of scalable state-machine replication is how to make use of the cores I have. How can I scale, essentially, with the number of cores? And this is something that I have been studying together with Dutch for a few years and some of his students. And it leads to a completely different, almost orthogonal direction of also achieving scalable state-machine replication. Okay, so I think that's what I had. If you would be happy to take any questions in English or in Portuguese.
Questions? English or Portuguese? this dynamic scheme, it always converges to best partition?
I don't think so. It converges to the best that Mathis can give us, and we know as a fact that Mathis it doesn't provide optimal results. It provides a good partition. It's considered a good graph partitioner, but this is an ongoing area of research. And from time to time, you see people proposing mechanisms that are more efficient, but they seem to all use Mathis as the baseline. So that shows that Mathis is good enough. This is one thing. The second thing is in this context here. There is many ways to measure the optimum, you know. One aspect is you want to minimize the number of data moves, right? So somehow it's not only that you want a good partitioning, but you don't want to have to reshuffle everything whenever you do a repartitioning. Mathis doesn't allow you to do that because there is no way to feed Mathis with the current partition. So ideally, what you'd like is not only to have a balanced load across partitions that minimizes the edge cuts, but also minimizes the data movements with respect to the previous partitions. You see, because if you run Mathis twice with a graph that is slightly different, the result can be something completely different. And as a consequence, a lot of stuff has to be moved around. Just because, because Mathis produced a different way to partition this, which had nothing to do with the previous way. As far as I know, no graph partitioner allows you to do that. But I guess that's if someone is looking for interesting problem to work on, I guess developing graph partitioner algorithms that take this aspect into account would be an interesting direction. So you can feed the algorithm with some previous state. So right now, I don't do any of that. There are other things that we do. When you want to aggregate things, you also want to keep track of how often commands happen, right? So it makes sense that if you have conflicting decisions, you want to optimize the one that's more frequent, right? So that you can assign weights to the edges, you can assign weights to the vertexes. Also, if you want to take into account the size of an object, a question that I often get is, don't you want to minimize the moves of large objects, right? You want to move the small ones. Some of that can be done by assigning weights to the vertices and edges. But the notion of a history, that one I haven't seen.
No. Yeah. Not a general question, not related. So, state machine replication is very important in practice. I mean, Google, every cloud system.
Right. They all have. They all have.
They all have something there to keep a strong consistency at some point.
Right.
And I know also that you have former PhD students in almost every of these places.
Yeah.
So what are they doing in practice to scale? Do you know?
Oh yeah, sure. No, some of the systems are fairly well documented, you know.
Uh-huh.
In many cases, I mean, social network is a kind of cool application, but in reality, the systems are not implemented like this.
Yeah.
What they do essentially is they give up strong consistency. So that's one thing they do.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can run in some anomalies, like I don't know, the typical anomalies. I post something. And then Tarcisius sees it, and then he posts something, and you see Tarcisius' post before you see my own post. That's an example of these anomalies that you can actually see. You know? So you can implement weaker version of consistency. Some of these systems, they implement stronger version of consistency within a partition and weaker versions across partitions, right? Essentially, for the reasons that I showed, there's a limit on what you can get. State partition is no miracle, you know. If you keep partitioning this thing, you're going to increase the cost of the applications. So some of the things that people actually do in practice is to give up on a strong partition. Sometimes, depending on the application, it's a reasonable. Some other systems like Google Spanner, for example, they at very very high level they do two things that are different. The first one is that they rely on a stronger underlying model, right? They have access to real time. So actually they have atomic clocks deployed at their data centers, if you can afford that.
Already deployed.
Yes. And then you can actually have a notion of time that's pretty much accurate across systems in different geographical locations. The second thing that they do is they use an execution model that's a bit different. In the model of state machine replication, the logic of your service, it resides in the server. So the server does the processing. But that's one way to do it. There are other way to do it, which is the clients, or what I'm calling clients here, is it can be an application server or some other level in your multi-tier architecture. They query the database, they query the servers for the data, and then they execute locally. And then any change, it's moved back to the servers. That's a different execution model, you know. So it doesn't require this assumption that whoever is going to execute this command, you must have all the commands. Right? The client is aggregating all the commands.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's actually, if you read something, you get the data from the server, and then you do any modification, and then you push the change. That's not how state machine replication works. State machine replication, the clients, they instantiate the commands. The execution happens at the server. So depending on the execution model you have, this has some differences.
Jeff, this second has
an
impact on consistency too.
Yeah, they all have. They all. I mean, all these models. They have flavors of strong consistency and weak consistency. Depends on the details of how you implement it. Stuff. There's also an impact on the level of transparency. You know, the clients, they have to execute the logic has reside in the clients as opposed to in the servers and so on.
And
yeah.
Now, abusing for your future prediction.
Yeah.
What do you think about this panacea of blockchain?
Oh man, the blockchain panacea. Actually, I think things are getting a little bit. I get the interesting times for blockchain are there starting for us, you know, for computer scientists working there. Because there's a little bit less hype, and also as the community starts to understand that a lot of these promises. They can't be fulfilled because they even contradict known lower bounds in distributed systems, you know. But things are getting more interesting, and as also the systems are becoming more concrete. So I don't know, and your guess is as good as mine. I think this is going to stay for some time. There are actually very interesting problems in this area. There's also related to this, you know. How to improve performance? These systems, they have pretty poor performance for a number of reasons, including the fact that everything runs as a full copy. Every node that has a full copy of the system, you know, obviously this can scale. So what can you do about that? That's a number of different things you can do. One of them is sharding, as I said.
Now, in the context of blockchain, this introduces other complications that that are related to, you know, proving to others that what you are doing is valid. So but it's a very nice, from research perspective, it's a very nice area of work. Also, another one is some of the systems they claim, you know, or even they are deployed in hundreds of servers. You know, well, if you have all the servers exchanging messages, there's going to be a lot of messages. Yeah. So how can you actually reduce the number of messages and still involve all the servers? And finally, they even tolerate Byzantine failures. So it's a bit of everything on steroids. So it's actually it's an interesting research direction. Yeah. Just as a okay.
Coming back to your explanation on dynamic schemes, how can the Oracle always know? Because he has to know every change that happens to the state.
Yeah.
How can he always know without being too intrusive into partitioning systems? Because he cannot be querying every time, right?
Okay, yes, very good point. So whenever you relocate an object, you have to involve the Oracle, right? So that there's no way out, because the Oracle is the entity that knows where things are, right? If you don't have that, then it becomes a lot more complicated. Just you have to, I don't know, query on the server. So we stick to this assumption. The Oracle knows the mapping. But there's another thing, which is, I think, perhaps what we are referring to is, so to do the partitioning, one thing is to know, well, this variable is in this partition and that variable is in that partition. Another thing is to know, how are these variables related? And that depends ultimately on the execution of the command. So we don't want to involve the Oracle too much, because it becomes a performance bottleneck. The way to avoid queries for mappings is the cache that I told you about. The other one is the partitions. They collect information about the commands and how they are accessed, and from time to time they send this data to the Oracle. So you don't involve the Oracle all the time. You get the information and you push it to the Oracle.
But
Alexandra
sent a message for the Oracle, because even in the case that he mentioned, it looks like Oracle will be overloaded, right? Because if they need to know where the objects are,
yeah.
And also if he is receiving a message from the partition, it will be overloaded.
Yes, I guess yes. You have a point. So the Oracle is not going to be. So let's assume that the moment where the system reaches some stable as possible. So in that point, the Oracle is not going to be queried so much for commands, because the clients, they cache data, and data is kind of updated. But it's true that in some of these workloads, you still, even in stable state, you have to exchange messages, right? You have to relocate data, and then involve the Oracle. We have actually observed that. And the current status of the system is that you don't relocate for the execution of a command. You don't relocate. You borrow the object. So the advantage of borrowing the object is that you don't have to involve the Oracle for the repartition. So the Oracle is only involved really if you don't have, you have wrong cache data. So if your cache data is outdated, then you have to go to the Oracle. This happens rarely. Now for the execution of commands, again, because you are not repartitioning, you're just borrowing the object, so you don't have to go to the Oracle. That has boosted performance by quite a margin. So we didn't realize when you designed the system. So perhaps if you were involved, you go straight to the to the new design.
More questions? So let's thank Professor Pedone. Thank you. So just for the record, Professor Pedone is quite active with us here since several years, and it's really a pleasure, because we have also the opportunity sometimes to send master students to his group in Switzerland. So this is a rare opportunity, because fostering master students abroad is quite difficult. We do have sandwich doctorate scholarships available, but not at the level of master degree at all. So there are some possibilities for 3 months stays
good point.
In his school. Right now, there is one student of us here a year. He's just has got installed.
Yeah, just sent me an email this morning saying that you're right.
And
thanks for reminding me that. So we have this grants. It's a program that has going on for a few years now. Not necessarily my area. It's for the whole the department. So the people propose projects, right? Once a year, we collect project ideas from the professors. We publish this, and then the students they pick a project and they submit their application. And so far it hasn't been. It's not too crowded. So there's a good chance that if you want to do this, there's going to be a grant for you. You're going to have another, the next deadline, I think, is going to be in the second semester. I send you the link.
Yeah,
so there's projects in our areas, actually, including this.
Yeah. Most important.
Yeah, exactly.
And Lugano is a very interesting city.
Yeah.
It's very nice.
Especially in the summer.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, thank you again.
Yeah, thank you.